Hey folks, I'm going to talk to you a little bit this evening about a thing called the National Defense Authorization Act. We call it the NDAA. So what that is how we, it's our authorization of the United States military to protect the country. This is where we do it in the National Defense Authorization Act. Happens every single year, and just like every other bill, you decide whether the things that you hate in it can be tolerated for the things that you cannot stand. And we're working through that right now. But I just want to let you know where I am. I'm beyond disgusted with the circumstance that we're in, with what the president is doing, what the speaker is doing regarding this bill, and quite honestly, what the Department of Defense is doing. We all want to support the men and women who defend our country. They need our support. They need the equipment. They need to have what they need to do their job. And politicizing it and filling it with a bunch of things that have absolutely nothing to do with the defense of America is abhorrent to me. I'm going to be forced to tolerate it, but I will tell you, I'm not going to be a part of it. Right now, I'm planning to vote no, and I say that because we're working on the bill. It's literally going to be probably thousands of pages, but we're still amending it at this hour, and I'm going to have to vote on it probably tomorrow morning. That's just the way things go around here. So let's just start with some of the most egregious things. It's $25 billion more than the president actually asked for. It's the highest dollar amount figure ever, and you might say, well, so what? What does that matter? Well, here's why it matters, because your money, whether it's overseas contingency funding or the $25 billion extra, should go to troops, should be going to help troops. But actually, most of that money's not going to help troops. It's going for superfluous things that they don't even actually list in the bill. Like, they don't even say what we're buying with the $25 billion extra dollars, right? It closes down Guantanamo, ladies and gentlemen, because the party in power, Speaker Pelosi, doesn't want those poor Al-Qaeda and ISIS people in Guantanamo. So they're going to bring them to the United States. And you know what they're going to do when they bring them to the United States, like they're doing with most of the other prisoners? They're going to let them out on the street. And people say, well, that can't happen. That's never going to happen. Ladies and gentlemen, four of the Guantanamo Five that we let free, that President Obama set free in trade for Bo Bergdahl, who was a treasonous traitor to this country, are now in charge in Afghanistan. So don't tell me it's not going to happen. So it closes down Guantanamo. It orders the creation of the Office of Countering Extremism. Let me tell you what that means. That means the Secretary of Defense is going to put an officer in every unit to determine your political ideology. And if you don't match up, you're out. Why do we? This is what communists did in Russia. I really shouldn't have to explain that to you any more than what it is. Why we need a litmus test about your core values and your political values for people that are currently serving, I find that so objectionable, I can barely speak about it. It creates a military court for gun confiscation orders. These are ex parte. What does that mean? That means if somebody doesn't like you in the military and they accuse you of something, you can have your firearms. You're in the military. You carry a firearm for a living, yet your personal firearms are going to be taken from you without you actually being in court to defend yourself, and then they're going to figure it out later. Does that sound like America to you? This is the beginning of where it happens. This, it starts in the military, and then it comes to your home. Completely unacceptable to me. Codifies the so-called diversity, inclusion, and equity requirements for service academy cadets. That's critical race theory, folks. That's dividing American service members based on their race. When you're in a unit fighting the enemy, you need to be focused on the enemy and be together as a team, not deciding whether you can be together as a team based on someone's skin color. The military is the most diverse organization in the United States of America. And no one cares what your skin color is. They don't care what your religion is, where you come from, how rich you are. They care whether you can do the job. Critical race theory has no place in the military, yet we're gonna enshrine it in this bill. All right, communist China in our markets. I had a couple amendments, and it's not about my amendments. Look, if they would have just written the bill, as long as they do it, it's okay. But it gives access to the Chinese Communist Party to our financial markets, which they then use to build and buy and steal the weapons that they're going to use against the very people that are funding it. It's complete. It's ludicrous. It invests in unreliable weapon systems. I'll just give you the F-35 fighter fleet. In 2018 and 2019, the DoD reported that it lagged behind in operations and ability readiness, and its weapon systems were unacceptable. Now the NDAA called for, the president wanted 5. So what do we do when he wants 5? We're gonna give him 85. 85 weapon systems that don't really work. That's brilliant. That's just brilliant. Again, we're gonna outsource our national defense to China. We're gonna buy 30 Virginia-class attack subs. And I actually support buying the 30 Virginia-class attack subs. $22.2 billion. We're going to build 9 of them. But we now import 80% of the critical minerals from China used to build these submarines. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? We're funding our enemy. We're reliant on our enemy to build our weapon systems to defend ourselves against our enemy. What kind of insanity? This is in. They want to put this in the law. They're going to put it in the law. Let me see. I had an amendment. Again, it's not about my amendment. If they would just put it in the bill, I don't care who gets credit for it, to revoke Afghanistan as a major non-NATO ally. I don't know if you're keeping up with recent events, but Afghanistan is not really a NATO ally, yet we're going to continue to treat them like they are. What does that mean to you as the taxpayer? What does that mean to you as an American who's concerned about your national security, your security right at home? Well, here's what it means. When you go to work every day, a portion of your paycheck is going to be sent to Washington, D.C., and they're going to send it to Afghanistan that's run by the Taliban to buy weapons, to fix their country, to take care of the people that are oppressed because they're chopping their heads off. You couldn't make this up. I don't think you could, but that's what we're going to do. This is one that really, really frosts me. Let me get to this other one first. Climate and environmental policy authorizes another $549 billion. That's a lot of money, $549 billion for environmental cleanup in the military. Ladies and gentlemen, the enemy doesn't have a recycling program. They don't have a renewable fuels program. What they're interested in doing is killing Americans and winning. What we need to be focused on is training our service members to do the best job they can with the best equipment that they can get and defeat the enemy. Yet we're going to spend your tax dollars on this stuff. There's other organizations in the federal government that do these things. This is not the military's job is to defend the country, not have a renewable fuels program, not have all these different climate change studies and so on and so forth about their basing or electric vehicles in combat that can't be charged and the enemy's coming over the hill. It's absurd. And then finally, the funding to Pakistan. Now, I don't know whether you know this or not, but for the past 20 years when we've been at war with Afghanistan, we've been funding Pakistan, and long before that. Now, Pakistan's one of the major parts of their budget is the United States of America. Your tax dollars funding Pakistan because Pakistan's a nuclear power and we don't want anything bad to happen to nuclear powers. We're scared of them, right? So we fund them to make sure that they remain stable. What do they do with your money? Well, they give it to the Taliban. They give it, did you ever hear of this? The Haqqani Network. They give it to Al-Qaeda, Khorasan Group, ISIS-K. That's who the Pakistani ISI, the military entity that your tax dollar funds, gives that money to. And what do they do with it? Well, here's what they do with it, ladies and gentlemen. It's a dirty secret, but they kill American service members. They kill Taliban. They kill Muslim members of Afghanistan. They kill other Afghanis. They kill Christians. They're against us. We've been funding it. It's bad enough we funded it for 20 years, but after in disgrace, President Biden, along with Mark Milley, along with Secretary Austin and Secretary Blinken, surrendered the United States position and left $85 billion to a terrorist superstate that they just created. You know what they want to do? They want to continue funding Pakistan. Ladies and gentlemen, I spent almost 4 decades in uniform. My life revolved around the military. I set my calendar up based on my military service every single day. That's who I identified as. we're destroying the military. We're destroying one of the only bastions that have survived a couple centuries of American history as a standard that everybody respects and loves because it stood for righteousness and meritocracy and doing the right thing. I want to support the troops. I want to support everything that they need. I want to support the defense of our country. This isn't doing it. They're asking me to help in the demise of the institution that I served in for nearly four decades and that I'm dependent upon to defend our country. Ladies and gentlemen, I simply just can't. This isn't it. This is not it, and I'm not going to be a party to it. I just thought you'd like to know, so I thought I would tell you why I'm going to be a no on this bill. Those are the reasons. There's so many more, but there are always good things in the bill. You got to determine whether the good things are good enough to counteract the bad things. There's so much bad in this bill. We're handing our future to a terrorist super state in the Middle East and the Chinese Communist Party in this bill. I can't support it. Thank you.